Welcome to Smart Catalyst number 14, 2018. So these are the prelims articles. The first one is new index to check ease of doing agribusiness. The second one is about the tribals of Chhattisgarh. The third one is places in recent news. And the fourth article is Science and Technology Innovation Advisory Council. The fifth one is Indo-Russian military exercise. And the last prelims article is 7th RECP ministerial meeting. So the first article is new index to check the ease of doing agribusiness. So what the news here is, the center actually expects to roll out a new index, which is ease of doing agribusiness index. So why this index? In the sense, it is to increase the competitive spirit among the states, because the success of any policies or the reform initiatives which are proposed by the center is purely dependent on the implementation of those policies by the states. So to ensure that the reform agenda of government to be implemented at the desired phase by all the state governments, there is a need to develop these kind of competitive spirit among the states. So for that only, ease of doing agribusiness index is introduced. Okay. So now the government is focusing on agriculture, and we all knew that agriculture is a state subject. So by means of this index, the states will be ranked on the basis of reforms and investment in agriculture by the states, and the increased productivity, reduction of input cost, as well as the risk mitigation measures which are taken by the states. So these are the parameters, okay? And this is an agriculture ministry flagship scheme, which is only purely to encourage the agribusiness by all the state governments. So the reforms and the investment in agriculture have more weightage, and the marketing and the governance having somewhat 25 and 20 percentage weightage. So this index is not only based on these parameters, but also based on the success of reduction of farm inputs by means of distribution of the soil health cards to the farmers, as well as encouragement of the organic farming as well as micro irrigation. So the central government is going to take all these when calculating this ease of doing agribusiness index by to the state governments. So apart from this index, there is one more index which is brought by Niti Aayog, which is Agricultural Marketing and Farm Friendly Reforms Index. Okay. So it is, this index is also calculated based on the implementation of the reform measures by the states, and in that Maharashtra stood first and second is Gujarat. So the next article is Defy Threats and Voted. It is regarding the tribal people of Chhattisgarh. Okay. So what the news here is, during the recent Chhattisgarh election, despite of the Maoist threats, the tribal population's voting nearly accounts to 70%. So in this context, we have to know about the tribals who are in the Chhattisgarh region. So there are primarily five tribes in Chhattisgarh region. The first one is the Gond tribe. The second one is Bison Horn Maria tribe. And we are going to see in the subsequent slide the remaining tribes. Okay, so the first one, the Gond tribes, they derive the name from Gond, which means hill, and they are primarily the hunters and agriculturists, and they are the largest and the oldest tribe who are in that state, and they are popular for their unique system of marriage, which is the Gotul system of marriage, and they are mainly found in the Bastar district in Chhattisgarh. So the second one is Bison Horn Maria tribe, and they are getting their name because of their traditional headgear that they wear during the rituals as well as during their dance. And they are settled on the south of Indravati river in Chhattisgarh, and they worship earth as a deity. Okay. So the next tribe is Durva, and they are situated in the Bastar district in Chhattisgarh, and they are highly caste conscious, as well as they give more importance to the status hierarchy, and they mainly relies on the agriculture as well as selling articles which is made of cane. So the next tribe is Dorla, and they usually found in Dantewada district in Chhattisgarh, and they are interested in beaded jewelry as well as braided locks, which are called Kosha. And they celebrate festivals all round the year, and they have more faith in spirits, which is often reflected in their traditional practices. So the last tribe is Abuj Maria, and they are one of the oldest tribes in the Chhattisgarh region. So they are very closed and they are very conservative. So they have no contact with other social communities, and they are especially known for their aggressive nature. So they mainly dependent on the hunting for their survival. So the next article is Places in Recent News. So it is about the Sea of Galilee. So what the news here is, recently there is a major concern over this Sea of Galilee because it is shrinking. So in that perspective, now we are going to see the places which is surrounding the Sea of Galilee. So it is entirely present in the Israel, So if you see in this picture, the Jordan River, right? It is the main source of water to this Sea of Galilee. Some more facts about the Sea of Galilee is, it is the second lowest lake of world after Dead Sea, because Dead Sea is a saltwater lake, right? And the Sea of Galilee is the first lowest freshwater lake, okay, in the world. And this is also known as Sea of Tiberians. So if you see the areas near the Sea of Galilee, here you can see the Golan Heights, right? So it is a dispute area between Syria and Israel. So the places that surrounds Israel are Jordan, Egypt, Mediterranean Sea, Lebanon, and Syria. So the next article is Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council, which is STIAC. So it is a 21-member advisory panel on science, technology and innovation, and it renders advice on all the matters related to science, technology as well as innovation, as well as it monitors the implementation of those visions. So this committee replaced the earlier Scientific Advisory Committee to PM and to Cabinet in August 2018. So if you see the composition of this committee, then it is headed by the principal scientific advisor, and he is the chairperson. And apart from that, it also contains 9 members, and also it has 12 special invitees related to science, technology, energy, as well as education. So now we are going to see what are the functions of such committee. So it is mainly focuses on rendering advice, like it advises the Prime Minister on science, technology, as well as innovation, and it coordinates the implementation of such vision, as well as it ensures the timely implementation of such visions, and it advises the government on developing clusters of excellence, including the city-based research and development clusters. Apart from that, it brings together all science and technology partners from academia as well as institutes to industries near the centers or cities. So the next article is inauguration of Hunar Haat at India International Trade Fair, New Delhi. So what the news here is, recently the Ministry of Minority Affairs organized this Hunar Haat initiative under Ustad scheme. So now we are going to see what is this initiative. Actually, it is aiming to provide the market as well as opportunity for the artisans and the craftsmen who are already engaged in the traditional ancestral works. Okay, so it is basically to train the traditional arts and crafts for development. So the Ustad scheme aims at preserving and promoting the rich heritage of our country as well as the traditional arts and crafts of the minority communities. So it is one of the flagship program of the Minority Affairs Ministry. So by means of this initiative, they actually aiming at empowering the artisans and craftsmen, thereby they can increase the employment opportunities for these people. So the next article is Indo-Russian Joint Exercise Indra 2018. So it is about the joint military exercise, which is Indra 2018, which is under the aegis of United Nations for combating the insurgency. So it is a military exercise between India and Russia. So it is going to be held at Babina Military Station at Uttar Pradesh, and it is the 10th exercise in the series of this Indra exercise. So these exercise will strengthen the mutual confidence between the two countries, as well as it increases the interoperability and enable the sharing of the best practices between the two armed forces of India and Russia. So what is the aim of such exercise is to practice the joint planning between India and Russia, and also to enhance the interoperability between the two armies in terms of peacekeeping as well as enforcement environment. So the next article is 7th RCEP Intersessional Ministerial Meeting concludes in Singapore. So first we have to know what this RCEP means. It is a free trade agreement which is negotiated between 16 countries, and those 16 countries constitute 10 ASEAN members plus 6 countries. So those 6 countries are India, South Korea, China, Japan, as well as Australia and New Zealand. Okay. So it is the free trade agreement, that is regional free trade agreement between these 16 countries, and it constitute nearly 50% of the world population and 22% of the global GDP. So what the news here is, recently the RCEP meeting was being held by low level officials of these countries. But today, the high-level officials, such as the head of the each state, are going to participate in this RCEP meeting. And they are going to discuss on these topics mainly, such as the economic and technical cooperation, small and medium enterprises, institutional and government procurement provisions, sanitary and phytosanitary measures, etc. So now we are going to see the main articles. The first one is Four Corners about Quad Security Dialogue. The second one is Changing Trends on the Global Petroleum Market. The third one is A Reality Check on Cooperative Federalism Between the Center and the States. And the last main article is India and the Promise of Service Revolution. So the first main article is the Four Corners, which is on the Quad Security Dialogue. So what the news here is, the officials from the quadrilateral grouping of India, Australia, Japan, as well as US is going to meet on Wednesday, that is today. So during this meeting, they are expected to discuss on various things like the infrastructure projects between those countries they are working on, and building the humanitarian disaster response mechanism during the natural disaster situations and all. So, and apart from this, these four countries are expected to talk about regional developments like elections in Maldives, collapse of the government in Sri Lanka, as well as the latest changes or developments which is taking place in North Korea. Now we are going to see what is Quad first. So it is a informal strategic dialogue that maintained by the low-level official talks regarding the Indo-Pacific region. So it mainly trying to improve the prosperity, peace and stability in the Indo-Pacific region. But there are certain issues. The first one is, there is no common agenda for these Quad countries. And the second one is, there is no common definition for the geographical area which is encompassed by these Quad countries. They are actually aiming to create prosperity and peace in the Indo-Pacific region, but there is no clear definition for those geographical extent or geographical area encompassed. And the third major issue is, even in the maritime exercise which is being held between those countries, there is no concurrence. So these are the major issues. So despite of all these issues, now they are going to participate in this third round of Quad meeting in Singapore. So now we are going to see what are the concerns regarding this Quad countries. So the first thing is, there is no consensus among the region which is described by these countries as Indo-Pacific region. For example, US claims that the region between India and US, this entire region is Indo-Pacific. But at the same time, India and Japan claimed that the region up to Africa, so this entire region is Indo-Pacific region. So there is no concurrence between these countries in terms of Indo-Pacific region definition itself. And also recently, India is not admitting Australia in the Malabar exercise, which was being held among these countries like India, Japan and US. So Australia is not admitted into this exercise by India. So these are all the concerns about this Quad countries. So now we are going to see what is the background of this QSD, which is the Quad Security Dialogue. So it was formed in the year 2007 following the cooperation after 2004 tsunami incident. And it is especially to coordinate the maritime capabilities among the countries, especially during disaster situation. But after the withdrawal of Australia from QSD, it actually ceased to be exist. But in the year 2017, it again got revived. So this revival of the QSD is seemed to be an action which is by the Quad countries in order to counter the China's dominance in the Indo-Pacific region, though the denial that any particular country has not been targeted, but it seemed to be a counter initiative for China's dominance. Now we are going to see the Quad cooperations. So if you see in terms of Quad cooperation, it is like India and Japan announced that they will combine their efforts on number of projects in South Asia, especially the projects including the bridges and roads in Bangladesh, an LNG facility in Sri Lanka, and the reconstruction projects in Myanmar's Rakhine province. And also the Australia plus the Quad countries are doing the infrastructure project in the Pacific region. So these are the recent cooperations among the countries of the Quad. So what is the concern over here is, though each and every member of the Quad country is committed to build a strong Quad engagement among themselves, India is the only member which is not in a treaty alliance with these Quad countries. So even though Quad has potential, it is in the hands of India that we have to develop a strategic vision when it comes to Quad engagement among the countries. And the outcome of such engagement can only be visible and judged by the ability of this Quad group to issue a joint declaration, which is not achieved in the first and the second Quad meetings. So the next article is changing trends on the global petroleum market. So what the news here is, the fears of slowdown in the global growth and the extension of oil consumption have prompted the sharp fall or decrease in the equity as well as the crude prices in recent weeks. So this change in prices or decrease in crude oil prices have raised a question that on what basis these crude oil prices getting fluctuated. So in this picture, you can see whatever fluctuations which has happened in and around the world, it is going to affect the price of the crude oil. For example, the Chinese growth takeoff, the financial crisis, the Arab Spring, or the Iran nuclear tension, the conflict in Yemen. So whatever happened in and around the world is going to affect the crude oil prices. So recently, the OPEC members desired to ramp up or increase the supply of the crude oil, but in turn the Saudi Arabia actually cut the supply of the crude oil, which in turn they believed that this kind of production cut actually increases the price of the crude oil, but it is actually not going to increase the crude oil prices as much as what they expected. So if you see in terms of fluctuations, the crude oil prices is like in early October, it was like $85 per barrel. But it is now, that means in last Friday, it is slipped to like $70 per barrel. And again on Monday, it increased to $72. And again on Tuesday, it is like falling by $69 per barrel. So this change in prices in the crude oil can easily make it visible that even a small change or small fluctuation in the economy can lead to a larger change in the price of the crude oil to a very greater extent. You have to understand one thing here, that is the Saudi Arabia actually wants to increase the price of the crude oil. They just want a sustained rise in the crude oil prices. But there are certain risks associated with such kind of sustained rise, because the US is strongly opposing to the higher oil prices, and the Saudi, Iran, they are OPEC countries, right? But this US is equivalent to that, but it is a non-OPEC supply growth of the same crude oil. And the increase in output of the shale, as well as any slowdown which has happened in the global economic growth, these are all the risks associated with the sustained rise in the oil prices. So these are all the barriers to the rise in the oil prices, which is actually expected by the Saudi Arabia. So now we are going to see what is this OPEC, which means Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries. So it is a permanent intergovernmental organization, and it is an international cartel of independent producers of crude oil. So their main goal is to increase the profits of the producers by means of price fixing, limiting the supply of the crude oil, as well as other restrictive practices. So by means of doing all these, they always try to increase their profits. It currently consists of 15 countries. And what does the OPEC actually do is, they coordinate and unify the petroleum prices among the member countries to secure fair and stable prices of the petroleum products all around the world, as well as an efficient economic and regular supply of the petroleum to the consuming or the destination nations. And they always aim at the fair return on the capital to those who are investing in the industries. So if you see, it is created at the Baghdad conference on September 1960. So these are the 15 OPEC countries, and the Democratic Republic of Congo is the last country to join in this OPEC. The next article is a reality check on cooperative federalism. So this article talks about the cooperative federalism, which is a basic feature of the constitution. So if you see historically, all the states are always have sought to parity or equality with the center, which is explicitly mentioned in Sarkaria and Panchsi Commission's recommendations. But even though they sought for parity or equality, there is always a gap between the constitutional provisions, which in terms of federalism, and the political reality which is present in the existing scenario. So even if in case of precedent rule imposition under Article 356, or in terms of sharing of power between the center and the states, or in terms of sharing of taxes or revenues between the center and the states, so anything if you take, it is always the central government which won most of the disputes purely due to the express provisions or the explicit provisions which is in the constitution. So these are two important case One is SR Bommai versus Union of India case, and another one is Government of New Delhi versus Union of India case. In these two cases, the Supreme Court again upheld the importance of federalism, which is the basic feature of the Constitution. So it is in this case, the Supreme Court actually tilted its balance of support towards the government of NCT rather than the central government. So by means of this, we can easily understand that how much federalism is important for any country. So the first major concern over this cooperative federalism is the sharing of the taxes between the center and the state. So after the GST amendments into the constitution, the states which were having the octroi or entry tax or luxury and entertainment taxes before is now transferred to the center's ambit, and now the states are having only the power over the taxes which they are collecting through the panchayats and municipalities. And also one more thing, that is the states have the power to levy taxes on petrol and diesel sales, but the GST council is not yet included those items into the GST items. So these clearly shows the inequality in the sharing of the taxes or tax jurisprudence among the center and the state. So now you have to understand one thing, that is under Article 269A1 of GST council, it clearly states that it is the GST council which is having the power to make recommendations in relation to the sharing of the taxes from interstate trade. Okay, so GST council has to decide the sharing of the taxes in terms of interstate trade, and it is not the finance commission. But in the article 271A of the GST council, it stated like the taxes which is levied under the GST laws will be shared in a manner which is prescribed in the article 272. Okay, so whatever the manner which is prescribed here, according to that only you have to share the tax. That is what stated in this article. Okay, but in this what they stated is it is the finance commission which is having the power to say or determine or recommend the sharing of the taxes. So there is a confusion here, right? So it states like GST council has the power, it states like finance commission has the power. So this anomaly between the roles and the powers of the finance commission and the GST council is raising a question that whether really the federalism is followed in our country or not. So you have to note one thing here, that is the GST council, the states are having more power because the states are having the voting right in the GST council. So, but it is actually tilted towards the finance commission, right? So it is like reducing the power of the state in terms of sharing of the taxes. And there are certain concerns over here, that is, so here there are two major concerns. One is there is no provision for an aggrieved state to challenge the finance commission report or seek the enforcement of such recommendations. And the second major concern is if at all a center refuses to make allocation of the taxes as per the GST council, or if a state is aggrieved of recommendation itself, so center refusing the state's part or the state is aggrieved itself, then the state should or it would go to the Supreme Court for the litigation, because GST council has not yet established any mechanism for the resolution of these kind of disputes between the center and the state. So these are the concerns which need to be addressed. So it is the true test of cooperative federalism which is in our country. So the last mains article is India and the promise of service revolution. So this article talks about the fourth industrial revolution and its positives and negatives. So now we are going to see the former revolutions. So these are the former revolutions. The first industrial revolution is using of steam power to mechanize the production. The second is using of electric power to create more production. And third one is electronics to automate the production. And the fourth, which is happening now, is the digital revolution, like artificial intelligence, robotics, IoT, which is the Internet of Things, and cloud computing, etc. So this fourth industrial revolution has certain positives as well as certain negatives. The positive in terms of the fourth industrial revolution is it contributes bulk of the GDP, that is, it is a major contributor to the GDP, especially in the developing countries, which like it dominates the manufacturing sector. It is more than the manufacturing sector. But what is the negative thing here is the redefining of the skills, that is skilling of the youths in terms of or in order to adopt with the flow of this industrial revolution is a major hurdle. because it needs new different skills, technological know-how, problem solving and critical thinking. So skilling up the youth in line with this is a difficult task or a major concern. So in terms of this fourth industrial revolution, what is India's scenario in the sense? The trade in services sector as well as the labor productivity in services sector is dominating the trade and labors in manufacturing sector. That is, service sector is dominating the manufacturing sector in terms of India, as well as the labor productivity growth in China in terms of manufacturing is equivalent to the productivity growth in services in India. So that much we are actually improving in terms of services. So the World Bank study shows that this fourth industrial revolution actually promotes the global growth convergence between the developed and the developing countries by means of this technology utilization. And this technology or these digital technologies actually open newer avenues of sustainable, inclusive and smart development. So India has one advantage that it has one of the most youngest population in the world. So by means of leveraging this fourth industrial revolution technologies and innovation ideas, we can easily make or increase the quality of the human capital or which is available in our country. So what is the way forward here is, as India has more demographic dividend, we have to make use of that opportunity by means of investing more in the human capital. And the policymakers should need to scale up the emphasis on sound infrastructure delivery plan, both in terms of physical infrastructure as well as the human infrastructure investments. And apart from investing in the infrastructure project, we have to invest more in human capital stock also. So the soft skills which is needed for the current scenario, that is in terms of this fourth industrial revolution, need to be skilled for the youths. Thank you.